And let us continue our prayer in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Good morning to all of you, wherever you may be. We welcome you to this Mass on the fourth Sunday of Lent, traditionally called Lectari Sunday. That's why I look fabulous in pink today. And it's a reminder to us on this Lectari Sunday, which means rejoice in Latin, that our Lenten journey is halfway over. And so it also is a reminder to us to rejoice that the Lord is with us. And during this time of COVID-19, during this time of uncertainty and fear, we are reminded that God is with us. Our readings today are all about seeing, to see beyond the obvious, beyond the physical, to see as God sees. And we know we don't always do that. So let us come before our God who is full of gentleness. Let us come before a God who is full of compassion and love. Let us come before a God who is leading us during this time. And let us ask that God for pardon and for peace.
Lord Jesus, you came to reconcile us to one another and to the Father. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Lord Jesus, you heal the wounds of sin and division. Christ, have mercy.
Forgive us our sins and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Amen.
Let us pray. O God, through your word, reconcile the human race to yourself in a wonderful way. Grant, we pray, that with prompt devotion and eager faith, the Christian people may hasten forward toward the solemn celebrations to come. We ask this through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
Amen.
I think the readings today are quite spectacular, and I'd just like to set them up just a little bit for us on this fourth Sunday of Lent. All the readings today have the theme of seeing. Our first reading today from 1 Samuel. Samuel does not see as the Lord sees. Samuel is coming to anoint the next king, which is David. But Samuel doesn't see that quality in David. But God does. God sees the heart. Samuel only saw the physical. And in our second reading today, it echoes the theme of the gospel. The gospel, Jesus says, I am the light of the world. And that is picked up in our second reading from Paul's letter to the Ephesians, where Paul exhorts the people to live as children of the light. And so all of our readings today are about seeing in light and trusting that God is guiding. Fabulous readings today. Let us listen.
A reading from the first book of Samuel. The Lord said to Samuel, fill your horn with oil and be on your way. I am sending you to Jesse of Bethlehem, for I have chosen my king from among his sons. As Jesse and his sons came to the sacrifice, Samuel looked at Eliab and thought, surely the Lord's anointed is here before him. But the Lord said to Samuel, do not judge from his appearance or from his lofty stature, because I have rejected him. Not as man sees does God see, because man sees the appearance, but the Lord looks into the heart. In the same way, Jesse presented seven sons before Samuel. But Samuel said to Jesse, "The Lord has not chosen any one of these." Then Samuel asked Jesse, "Are these all the sons you have?" Jesse replied, "There is still the youngest who is tending the sheep." Samuel said to Jesse, "Send for him. We will not begin the sacrificial banquet until he arrives here." Jesse sent and had the young man brought to them. He was ready, a youth handsome to behold and making a splendid appearance. The Lord said, "There, anoint him, for this is the one." Then Samuel, with the horn of oil in hand, anointed David in the presence of his brothers. And from that day on, the Spirit of the Lord rushed upon David. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Is my shepherd, there is nothing I shall want. The Lord is my shepherd, there is nothing I shall want.
The Lord is my shepherd, there is nothing I shall want. The Lord is my shepherd, there is nothing I shall want.
The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. In verdant pastures he gives me repose. Beside restful waters he leads me. He refreshes my soul.
The Lord is my shepherd, nothing I shall want. The Lord is my shepherd, there is nothing I shall want.
He guides me in right paths for his name's sake. Even though I walk in the dark valley, I fear no evil, for you are at my side. With your rod and your staff that give me courage.
The Lord is my shepherd, there is nothing I shall want. The Lord is my shepherd, there is nothing I shall want.
You spread the table before me. In the sight of my foes, you anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows.
The Lord is my shepherd, nothing I shall want. The Lord is my shepherd, there is nothing I shall want.
Only goodness and kindness follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the for years to come.
The Lord is my shepherd, there is nothing I shall want. The
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Ephesians. Brothers and sisters, you were once darkness, but now you are light in the Lord. Live as children of light, for light produces every kind of goodness and righteousness and truth. Try to learn what is pleasing to the Lord. Take no part in the fruitless works of darkness. Rather, expose them, for it is shameful even to mention the things done by them in secret. But everything exposed by the light becomes visible, for everything that becomes visible is light. Therefore, it says, "Awake, O sleeper, and arise from the dead, and Christ will give you light." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Glory to you, O Word of God, Lord Jesus Christ. Glory to you, O Word of God, Lord Jesus Christ. Glory to you, O Word of God, Lord Jesus Christ. Glory to you, O Word of God, Lord Jesus Christ. I am the light of the world, says the Lord. Whoever follows me will have the light of life. Glory to you, O Word of God, Lord Jesus Christ. Glory to you, O Word of God, Lord Jesus Christ.
May the Lord be with you.
With your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John.
Glory to you, O Lord.
As Jesus passed by, he saw a man blind from birth. He spat in the ground and made clay with his saliva and smeared the clay on his eyes and said to him, "Go, wash in the pool of Siloam," which means sent. So he went and washed, and came back able to see. His neighbors and those who had seen him earlier as a beggar said, "Isn't this the one who used to sit and beg?" Some said, "Yes, it is." But others said, "No, he just looks like him." He said, "I am." They brought the one who was once blind to the Pharisees. Now Jesus had made clay and opened his eyes on the Sabbath. So then the Pharisees asked him how he was able to see. He said to them, "He put clay on my eyes, and I washed, and now I can see." So some of the Pharisees said, "This man is not from God, because he does not keep the Sabbath." But others said, "How can a sinful man do such signs?" And there was a division among them. So they said to the blind man again, "What do you have to say about him, since he opened your eyes?" He said, "He is a prophet." They answered and said to him, "You are born totally in sin, and you are trying to teach us?" Then they threw him out. When Jesus heard that they had thrown him out, he found him and said, "Do you believe in the Son of Man?" He answered and said, "Who is he, sir, that I may believe in him?" Jesus said to him, "You have seen him, and the one speaking with you is he." He said, "I do believe, Lord," and he worshipped him. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. optimist or a pessimist, or are you a person of faith? The classic test of this is a glass half full. A pessimist sees that glass half full and sees it as really half empty. An optimist sees that glass half filled with water and sees it as half full. A person of faith sees that glass filled halfway with water and simply thanks God for the water. I offer that to you because I think the scriptures today are challenging us to look at things from a different perspective. All the readings today challenge us to see beyond the physical, to see beyond the obvious, to see beyond the fear, to see beyond the uncertainty of our lives, and to see as God sees. And I think this is clear in our readings today. Samuel goes to find the next king. He does not see much in David. God sees beyond the physical to the heart and chooses David as the next king of Israel. The man born blind is blind physically, but eventually through Jesus' action, he not only regains his physical sight, but he sees spiritually that Jesus is the Messiah. Unlike the Pharisees have physical sight, but they don't have spiritual sight. They can't see beyond the physical. They can't see beyond the obvious. And I think that's the challenge of our readings today, to see beyond the physical, to see beyond the obvious, to see beyond the fear. So what does this have to do, or does it have anything to do with COVID-19, or does that have anything to do with the coronavirus? A couple of questions. How many times have you ever said, the world is moving too fast, I wish it would slow down? How many of you have ever said, I wish I had more time for the things that I love? How many of you have ever said, I wish I wasn't so busy? Good news is, God's granted those wishes. That's all true. We're all sheltered in place. We all have plenty of time right now. And so a spiritual way of looking at all this free time might be the phrase, learning to waste time gracefully. Most spiritual writers associate this as the definition of prayer. Learning to waste time gracefully is a great definition of prayer. But I think it's a great image for us in a larger, broader context during this shelter in place. Learning to waste time gracefully, because we all got a lot of extra time. So here's some thoughts. You know, we always say, I never have enough time to spend with the family. You do now. We never have enough time as family to play games or have a movie night. You have now. How about those of you who say, you know, I never have time to take a leisurely, lovely walk with my wife. You do now. And you know, the good news, even if you're having trouble with your spouse, you have a built-in 6-foot range between you as you walk now. Have you ever said, you know, I don't have enough time to clean the closet? You do now. Have you ever said, I never have enough time to take naps? Yeah, you do now. And I would say to you that probably the best thing for your immune system is plenty of rest. So get some rest. Learning to waste time gracefully. How about those of us who say, you know, I never have enough time to pray, to just spend some time with God? We do now. The church is open every day from 8 to 6. Come and visit the Lord. I never have enough time to write thank you notes. You do now. I never have enough time to read sacred scripture. You do now. And I would suggest to you, read the readings with the church weekdays for the next 2 weeks. They're beautiful. The fourth and fifth weeks of Lent, all the scripture passages weekdays start Jesus turning resolutely to Jerusalem. They're going to talk about God, Jesus preparing to die, Jesus going to the cross, Jesus going to Jerusalem, Jesus being rejected. All that fear, doubt, anxiety. Think that's going to apply to anything we're going through life right now? Read scriptures. You got plenty of time to do that now. What about you say, you know, I never have enough time to practice the piano. You do now. What about, I never have enough time to go to the back of my closet and find that guitar that's all dusty and play it again. Yeah, you do now. What about, you know, I never have enough time to write my Christmas cards. Start early this year. You can start those now. And another good one, I think, is, you know, we never have enough time to read the stories and lives of the saints. We do now. My dear friends, I started this homily off by looking at the differences between a pessimist and an optimist and a person of faith. You know, during this time, a pessimist and an optimist, neither one of them really know when COVID-19 is going to end. The pessimist or the optimist really aren't sure when this coronavirus is going to stop. The pessimist or the optimist, neither one of them really know when shelter in place is going to stop. The pessimist and the optimist both see the panic, the hoarding, the fear, the worry, the anxiety in the world. But the person of faith is looking at things much differently. The person of faith trusts that God is our light. The person of faith is trusting that God is leading us. The person of faith is seeing something different. They're seeing and thanking God for the water. The person of faith during this time is going to learn to waste time gracefully. Let's try that. I would invite us, as is tradition, to pray the Nicene Creed, the Apostles' Creed. Instead of the Apostles' Creed, the Nicene Creed, it's tradition we pray the Apostles' Creed. So we'll pray that now. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. The person of faith who's going to waste time gracefully can spend a lot of graceful time in prayer. And so now we bring our prayers for ourselves, for our family, for our friends, for our nation, for our world, to the attention of our God.
For the church, may God help us remain faithful to all his commandments and grow in the fullness of truth. Let us pray.
Oh, Lord, hear our prayer.
For the elected officials, may the Lord grant them the fortitude to remain true to his justice. Let us pray.
Oh, Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who suffer in mind, body, or spirit, may the healing power of Jesus come upon them and bring them comfort and peace. Let us pray.
Oh, Lord, hear our prayer.
For those gathered here, may the Holy Spirit increase in us a spirit of conversion and openness to his work in our lives. Let us pray.
Oh, Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who have died, especially because of the coronavirus, may they, through the mercy of God, rest in the fullness of peace. Let us pray.
Oh, Lord, hear our prayer.
And for all the prayers we have in the silence of our hearts, let us pray.
Oh, Lord, hear our prayer.
Let us also pray for doctors and nurses who are working long hours. Let us pray for researchers that they come up with a vaccine. Let us pray for all those who are filled with fear and doubt and worry that God will be with us and be the light in this darkness. We pray. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for through your goodness we have received the bread we offer you, fruit of the earth and work of human hands. It will become for us the bread of life.
Blessed be God forever.
Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for through your goodness we have received the wine we offer you. Fruit of the vine and work of human hands, it will become for us our spiritual drink.
Blessed be God forever.
Pray, my brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God the Father, the Almighty.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of God's name. For our good and the good of all God's holy church.
O Lord, we place before you with joy these offerings which bring eternal remedy, praying that we may both faithfully revere them and present them to you as a fitting gift for the salvation of the world. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just. It is our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. By the mystery of the Incarnation, Jesus has led the human race that walked in darkness into the radiance of the faith, and has brought those born in slavery to ancient sin through the waters of regeneration to make them your adopted children. Therefore, all creatures of heaven and earth sing a new song in adoration, and we with all the hosts of angels cry out, and without end we acclaim.
Holy, holy, holy.
Therefore, make holy these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and the blood of your Son, our Lord, Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate this Eucharist. At the time Jesus was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and giving thanks, broke it, gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it. For this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, Jesus took the chalice, once more giving thanks and praise to you, his Almighty Father. He gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me. The mystery of faith.
Save us, Savior of the world, for by your cross and resurrection, you have set us free.
Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of Jesus' death and resurrection, we offer you, Father, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that by partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit.
Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, Jose, our Bishop, and all the clergy and faith-filled people. Remember your servant, Monica Boland, my sister, whom you have called from this world to yourself. Grant that she who is united with your Son in a death like his may also be one with him in his resurrection. Remember also our other brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with the blessed apostles, with blessed Joseph, Mary's spouse, with St. Lawrence Martyr, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life. May praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ.
Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Family of God, wherever we are, let us pray the words that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. For the kingdom,
the power, and the glory are yours now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with all of you.
And with your spirit.
Wherever you may be and who's ever around you, we'd ask you to offer each other the sign of peace.
Peace.
On this day, quintolis peccata mundi, miserere nobis. On this day, quintolis peccata mundi, miserere nobis.
can receive the physical body and blood of Jesus today, wherever you may be, we would ask you to pray a spiritual communion. We'd ask you to pray that your heart and your soul and your mind grow in a desire for the Eucharist, even more, that you will have a greater desire to attend Mass, to grow in a closer relationship with God. So during this time, we would ask you to pray for that love of Jesus and the love of the Eucharist and the love of the Mass to grow in your heart during this time of absence.
Longing for light, we wait in darkness. Longing for truth, we turn to you. Make us your Lord, your holy people, light for the world to see.
Sincerity. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Now our pastor, Monsignor Paul, has a few announcements.
You didn't think there will be any announcements. There are no coffee and donuts, unfortunately, but we want to thank you all for being with us today and the other times that you've been with us during the week. Remember, we have daily Mass, we have Lectio Divina, we have the Rosary, and other spiritual things that you're able to, other opportunities, not things, opportunities that you're able to access through our website. We want to keep you in touch. We want to know that even though we are separated from you physically, we're not separated from you spiritually. And as Father said, this is a great time to uncover the presence of God within your families and within yourselves. So please go on to our website to see what we're offering on a day-to-day basis. So again, thank you for being here. Know that you are always in our prayers throughout the day. And as Father said, the church is open. We put a temporary tabernacle in the church so that you can come in and enjoy the presence of the Lord while you're there. So God bless you, and God be with you during this time.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
The Almighty God bless you all, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
This Mass is ended. Let us go forth glorifying God by the way we live our lives. Thanks
be to God.
Have a great day and a great week, everybody.
Take up your cross.